Well, it, first off, I just want you to know it's an honor and very humbling to be here with you this morning to just share with what God is doing in Winfield, but also just kind of a little bit of our story and how we kind of got to that point. Like I told the first service, it's okay if you don't like me. I promise you'll like my wife. She's the best part of this deal. The churches I've worked at, I told them that from the very beginning, and it was true. They liked her more than they liked me, so I'm okay with that. Hey, I'll keep a job as long as, you know, my wife is, you know, the best part of this deal. But anyway, before we kind of get into this and before I get too far, let's just go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just come humbly before you, and Father, we just thank you again. Just for who you are, Father. We thank you, Father, that that you love us and that you look down on us, Father, even as we are dead in our sin, Father, and you allowed your Son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place. Father, we do thank you. We thank you for that, Father, and I pray that that truth would move and shape everything that we do. And Father, I do pray that as I deliver this message here this morning, Father, I pray that if there's anything that comes from my mouth, from me, I pray it would be forgotten. And I pray that only the power of your word would remain. And I pray that the power of your spirit would teach us and remind us of all the things, Father, that you have taught us and that you want us to know. So, Father, we just, again, come humbly before you and ask that you'd be with us here this morning, that your spirit guide us. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, just a short little intro about who I am so that we kind of know each other. My name is Chris Hedges. My wife and my two daughters, my wife is Mandy, and my oldest daughter is Cashley, and my youngest is Cadence. And they are awesome. I love all the girls in my life. They are kind of what's helping me to be able to kind of do this church plant because it's a lot more difficult than I thought it would be. But anyway, I grew up in southern Colorado, and I'm just going to let you know, I know you heard Colorado, I'm no longer a Broncos fan anyway. Sorry, there's just so many Chiefs things in here, I had to say something. I grew up liking them, but then I've questioned some of their new management practices and new management, but that's a whole different sermon on character. But anyway, grew up in southern Colorado, grew up on a ranch. My granddad raised cattle. We rode horses. When I was 8 years old, I got bucked off my first horse. My granddad's words to me at that point for the rest of my life were always, one of these days you'll get tired of getting bucked off. There was no coddling there. You had to be all in growing up there, but loved it, kind of shaped who I was, shaped who I am. God used that in some really cool ways, and I think we'll continue to use that. Anyway, when I graduated high school, I drug my high school sweetheart, which was my wife, luckily, drug her down to Guymon, Oklahoma. Anybody familiar with the panhandle of Oklahoma in here? A few of you? All right, good deal. All right, so anyway, I drug her down there, and I went to work in some feed yards. And I was riding pins. That's the coldest place on the face of the earth. I don't care where you've been. It's the coldest place on the face of the earth when you ride pins. And then I moved around and drug her around to a couple different ranches and did different stuff. And just kind of was living the life that I had always hoped to kind of live. You know, grew up being a cowboy, always wanted to be a cowboy, and never dreamed of getting into ministry. It was never a thought, didn't grow up in church. I'll be real honest with you, they didn't even really like church. And so it's funny that I'm here sharing with you about planting a church. God has a sense of humor in that. But anyway, I had finally got to the point where I had my dream job. But the problem in there was is that I was a foreman on a ranch, but I was a miserable husband. And so there kind of came a decision in there where my wife said some things needed to change. And after I kind of sobered up one morning, I said, all right, well, what kind of needs to change? And she said, I don't know, like maybe we need to just try to go to church. I was like, all right, fine, whatever we need to do, because I knew I was a, I could look in the mirror and see what kind of a human being I was, and I didn't like it either. And so we went to church, and it just stuck. The Holy Spirit grabbed me, and I started volunteering with the youth, and in the process of volunteering with the youth, the place where I was working, I was having to leave early, and the manager came to me and said, hey, we can't have you leave early. Like, the other guys aren't getting work done. We need you to stay. And I said, well, I've got to keep helping these junior high kids, even though there's only two of them. And I've got to keep helping them. I just felt that call. And he said, well, you know, it's just not going to work. I told him, well, I can't work here. So I ended up, you know, quitting a job, and that made my wife real happy. You can imagine how that conversation went. Hey, I quit my job to volunteer with the junior high youth program. Didn't make sense. Even men who I knew in the community, they were like, wait, you did what? Like, what's your plan? And I said, I don't have one, but I know God does. And then about a year later, I actually ended up becoming an ordained minister, and they hired me to be their youth minister, which I still thought was crazy, still do at points, but I served there as a youth minister for 7 years, and then I got in contact with Nexus Church Planting out of McKinney, Texas, which CEA partners with, and they asked me to plant a church in Altamont, Kansas, which I didn't know where that was, and we looked at it, but we felt like God had called us maybe to stay where we are at, because the church where I had served as youth minister, they asked me to become the senior minister, and I served there for 4 years. We had some fruitful, good years there, but with some differences in leadership, like Paul and Barnabas, we decided that it was best to split directions and proclaim the gospel in new places. Again, I'm sure my wife's thinking, great, Chris, thanks, now what? Because we don't really have anywhere to go. So I call Phil, and we talk to Phil, and we start the process of, hey, would you guys be willing to let me plant a church? And they're like, well, yeah, sure, come on, have you ever thought of Winfield, Kansas? I thought, I've never even heard of Winfield, Kansas. So it was an adjustment, but we went and we looked at the community, and I just kind of fell in love with it. There was just something there that I knew God's Spirit was leading us there, and that there was going to be something for us there. And now we have lived there for like a week and a half. And it's interesting because we don't know a soul there. Okay, so I'm going to just throw this plug out to you. If you know anybody from Winfield, Kansas, come, you know, check with me after service. I'd love to meet who you know in Winfield, Kansas, because I don't know anybody. So, but we're excited about what God is going to do there, because we believe, as we have looked at the community, we have kind of run the numbers, and they have several churches there. But we know that as we have looked at it, run the numbers, even if there were 250 people in every single church in Winfield on a Sunday morning, we know that there would still be 8,000 that worked. And so we believe that the gospel needs to be proclaimed there, and I want to thank you for your faithfulness in helping make this happen. And so thank you, and with that in mind, one of the things that I think the church as a whole in America needs to kind of get on board with again is the idea that we were given a mission by Jesus Christ. We were given a mission, and we were meant to have a focus. We were meant to live in such a way that our lives would shine on eternity. And we have forgotten that in America as a whole in the church, because we have gotten comfortable. We have gotten busy. We have filled our schedules with lots of other things, and I think we just need to get our focus back. And I know for me, that was one of the things that led me to kind of get out of the church where I was. You know, it was an established church. They're celebrating 100 years this year, but I got comfortable. I liked going through the routines. I liked having a certain schedule of, well, I do this on these days and this and this and this, and I just got too comfortable, and I forgot the mission. I preached about it every Sunday, but I had forgotten it. Because for me, as I look at it, there's a scripture that really stands out to me and always has. It's in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, and I didn't have them put them up on the screen, but I'm going to read it to you. It says, whoever says he abides in him, talking about Jesus, whoever says he abides in Jesus ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. And the more I read that verse and the more I kept reading, I kept looking at my life saying, I don't know that this matches up. I am in ministry, but I don't think this matches up. Because Jesus left us an example that we should walk in the way that he walked. Now, this isn't a walk, you guys know this. This isn't perfection. We're not going to walk in perfection and sinless glory like Jesus did. But there is a way in which we are supposed to walk every single day. We're supposed to follow Jesus' example in the way that he dealt and interacted with people. And from there, it led me to the verses that we're going to be talking about today, and that's in Matthew chapter 9. It's this whole idea that we need to live like Jesus, because Jesus left us an example. And what I want to do is we're just going to read through these verses, verses 35 through 38. And we're just going to look at four things here that Jesus set an example that we should be following. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. That verse is also why we have decided to call the new church in Winfield, Kansas, Harvest Christian Church. Because as we have looked at it, we believe the harvest is plentiful, but man, the Lord needs some workers there. And so as we've gone with that, we see that Jesus, he set this example. Because in this, what's happening here in Matthew 9 is that Jesus takes his disciples on the third journey into Galilee. And this is going to be the third and final trip that he takes them there, but he's doing something here that is great. He's setting an example, because we're going to see in chapter 10 that he sends the disciples out after this. So it's this whole thing of Jesus is like, all right, I'm going to show you one more time, and then I'm going to send you out, see how you do. And I love that, because that's where we're at, is God sending us. And so we need to follow his example in this. And I would challenge you with this morning, is that follow Jesus' example here. The first thing that Jesus does, though, and the first thing that we should always be out there doing, is that Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. If you look at there in verse 35, as Jesus went throughout all the cities, villages, he was teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. That's what we're called to do. Because, right, and the whole gospel of the kingdom, I think really in our lives and our hearts can be summed up in John 10:10, where Jesus says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life and have life abundantly. See, I love this because sometimes I think we have forgotten this as Christians. Because like the church I come out of, like I'm not make a habit of picking on them, but here's the deal. My church and so many other churches, they got in the habit of living the Christian life was all about fire insurance, right? Just want to save us from the fire of hell, and we're going to live our lives just the same as we always did. We're just hanging on to the end. We've got our ticket, we're good. We don't need to do anything else. But what Jesus says here is that Jesus says, no, no, no. I have come that you may live life fully and abundantly now. That you may have the power of the Spirit in your life now. And that's the thing, is that we are called to live a kingdom life now. And so your life preaches the gospel. Your life should shine on to eternity. Because, right, that's the thing about that scripture that I love. And Paul, he sets this up in Galatians chapter 1. Turn over there with me to Galatians chapter 1. See, I think we've made it too complicated. Like, we come up with classes and programs and cubes and everything else on how we're supposed to share the gospel. And I think we just need to come back to what Scripture says we ought to do. Because I'm simple-minded that way, and I'm not a theologian, and here's what I see is that in Galatians chapter 1, starting at verse 13, Paul just kind of lines out how we're supposed to share the gospel. He makes it real simple. The first thing you do in sharing the gospel is share your story. Look, that's what he does in verse 13 and 14. He says, this is where I was. Okay, listen. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my father. So like right there, he's like, this is where I was. This is my story. This is where I come from. But see, then we get to the good part of the story. And for you and I, this is the good part of the story. But when Jesus steps in, who had set me apart before I was born, and who called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles. I did not immediately consult with anyone. He's just like, I just went, like here I was. I was ready to go proclaim the truth of Jesus Christ. This is where I was. Jesus showed up. And then he goes on in verses 17 through 24 to say, then this is the mission that Jesus sent me on. And then verse 24, I love it because it says, and they glorified God because of me. There should be people in your life that glorify God because of the example and because of your story. Your story is bigger and makes more impact on the people's lives around you than any preacher ever will. The people that you work with, your family, all of those people, if you would just share your story, what Jesus did in your life, it'd make a bigger impact than anything else that we could ever throw at them. Because that's where the rubber meets the road. People want to see where your life was changed. And so we must proclaim the gospel of the kingdom just like Jesus showed us we should. The second thing, if you turn back there to Matthew 9, is that Jesus restores the broken. In the old prophecy in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1, prophecy about Jesus, it says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring the good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound. That's what Jesus was sent for. Jesus restores the things that are broken. And here in Matthew 9 we see it. Is that as he went through the villages and he proclaimed the kingdom, he healed every disease and every affliction. And now for you and I, like, we're not going to go around and heal every disease and every affliction. But the truth that we do have is that we have the gospel that we were just talking about. We have your story. We have the power of what Jesus does. Because the truth is that around us, everywhere, are people that are broken and hurting. And they are searching for something. And what they are doing instead of finding Jesus, because the church has forgotten how to proclaim Jesus, is they are numbing it with drugs and alcohol and any other kind of thing that they can get their hands on. That's why we have, I don't know how many drug crises have we proclaimed now in the United States. It's because people are looking for things to numb the pain and the hurt when it's all the restoration they need is in Jesus. If we could just tell them about Jesus and what Jesus can do in their life, because look what he did in yours. There is restoration. And you see, that's why we plant churches. It's because there are communities just like Winfield where the church has forgotten that the way the community will be healed is not through, better, programs or a bigger building. It's through the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's going to come through people living it out. Or as we like to put it, with Winfield, our new church, is we want to leave Jesus' fingerprints everywhere we go. And so, one of the big things that we really want to do is we just want to try to find ways to serve. We've been able to work with the school so far. We've only been there a week and a half, but we're finding ways to serve already in the school because we just want to leave Jesus' fingerprints because there's a community that is broken that needs Jesus to restore it. The third thing that I would show you this morning that Jesus, he set this example, is in verse 36. Is that when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus, he saw the desperate need of the people. And when you study that word, that compassion word, you know, it's this whole, just as I've looked at it, it's this deep pulling, this love that comes from deep in his gut. Like he sees the need and he just knows that he's got to do something because they're harassed and they are without a shepherd. There's no one to guide them. Nobody cares for them and they're harassed. Truth is, you and I know all kinds of people around us that are harassed and helpless, don't have a shepherd. But the question is are we moved to do anything about it? Because we've filled our lives with so many other things, right? We're busy. I don't have time for that. But the example that Jesus left is that we should be moved from the pit of our stomach for those that are lost. Because I know that as we have again looked at the numbers in Winfield, there's about 48% of the town that claims to be Christians, and we know of that 48%, only about 30 to 33% maybe show up on a Sunday or do some sort of church activity. So if you go back and you know you're a math whiz and you know those numbers, I can't do that off the top of my head, but I know that that's a lot of people that are lost and need Jesus. So we are moved from the pit of our stomach to do something about it. But I would challenge you this morning. Are you moved from the pit of your stomach by the power of the Spirit to do something in your community? We must be willing to see people the way that Jesus sees people. That brings us to our fourth point here in this one. If you look at verse 37, then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." I like it how he words it in Luke. He says, "The harvest is ripe. It's ready." Jesus saw the potential. He saw all of these people that were hurting, harassed, without a shepherd. And he said, "Man, there it is. There's the harvest. It's plentiful. Let's get to work." Jesus saw them differently because I'm sure as the disciples looked at these people, they're like, "Man, this is a rough bunch." We would never do that, though, as the church, right? We never look at people outside that maybe need Jesus and go, "Man, that's kind of a rough bunch." We would never do that as the church, would we? See, here's the thing, is that we need to be able to see people differently. We need to be able to see people the way that Jesus sees people. We need to be able to see the potential of these people as possible brothers and sisters in Christ. Not just, "Oh, you know, that's just, you know, rough character. Or, oh, wow, they really need Jesus." Or like, you know, they say in the South where we're from, you know, "Bless their heart." We need to be able to see the potential and say the harvest is ready. It's ripe. And we need to be able to do that in all of our lives with those difficult people that we encounter every day. Anybody in here have somebody difficult they deal with every day or every week? Nobody wants to fess up to it. Oh, okay, that's all right. If you were to ask my wife, she would say I'm the difficult person that she has to deal with, and I would agree with her. But here's the deal, is that as we think about this, that difficult person that we have to deal with, what if we looked at them differently? What if we looked at them not as just a difficult person that just wants to make your life hard, but as somebody who is hurting? Maybe as somebody who has never been introduced to the healing power, the restoring power of Jesus Christ. What if we looked at them differently? And yes, I would say even the people that cut us off in traffic, because I'm driving up here, man, I've never been around traffic like you guys got up here. You would need a whole lot of Jesus in your heart to deal with that every day. Because you have to be able to see the potential of those people as somebody that would be a follower of Jesus Christ. We must choose to see that potential. And then when we get to this, I think then this is the most important part, is my second big point that I would give to you is that we have a command given by Jesus. Because here in verse 38, Jesus says something so powerful. He says, "Therefore pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Any great movement in the church has always started with prayer. So I would challenge you guys as a church to pray, or to keep praying. Pray for the harvest field here, but also pray for Winfield. Please pray that the Lord would send people into the harvest there. But pray for your community and your neighborhoods and your schools and whatever it is, wherever you work, pray that the Lord would send workers into that harvest field. But then what I really like is that Jesus says, "All right, you prayed up? Or are you prayed up, or are you ready?" Then he sends them out. The command for us to go. Because if you look at chapter 10 in verse 5, you know, after it names all the disciples, it says, "These 12 Jesus sent out." You see, once they saw the potential, once they saw the hurting and the broken and the need, Jesus says, "All right, now go. I want you to proclaim the kingdom." And then, you know, everybody knows, right? The Great Commission. You guys know Matthew 28:19-20? Every good Christian ought to know that one by heart. But we're cheating today because it's up on the screen. But this is what Jesus says to his apostles before he leaves. And I know I've read some story or some theologians say, well, this was specifically for the theologians, but I'm not a theologian, so I just take it at Jesus' word. He says, "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the very end of the age." See, Jesus, he sent us. He sent us into the harvest field. He said, "Go, proclaim the gospel, restore the broken, bring hope. And pray for the harvest field." I shared earlier that I, on the way up, we heard an interesting quote from a preacher. He was a singer, and he was talking about a preacher had challenged him with a message. But the preacher had asked, "If God answered all of your prayers, would it affect anyone besides you?" And I had to think about that. Because even as we are trying to plant a church, I've got some pretty selfish prayers. So we need to be willing to pray for a bigger harvest. We need to be willing to pray for something big. We need to have some big, audacious prayers of God. Do a mighty work wherever we're at. We need to be willing to pray for that, but then be willing to go too. And I would challenge you to go. To your community, to the people around you, to your family members that maybe don't know Jesus. Go. Preach the gospel. Restore the brokenness that is there. Have compassion for where they're at, but see the potential. Because I know that for us, as we look at this idea of planning a church, it seems overwhelming, but we know that we serve a mighty God. But I think the question that we all have to be willing to answer is whether or not we're willing to go. Because we have become comfortable. We have become sometimes apathetic about sharing our faith. The thing that I would challenge you with before I close this morning is that eternity matters. And salvation hangs in the balance every moment. The people that you know that don't know Jesus, there's no guarantee that you could share with them tomorrow. So do we care? You know, we're the body of Christ and we say we love others. But do we care that there is a harvest that is ripe? Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, just come humbly before you this morning again. And I thank you, Father, for your word. Father, I thank you for the example that Jesus left us. I pray, Father, that you would help us to look at your word, to study it, that your spirit would guide us in the things that we need to be doing. And Father, I do thank you for this church. I pray that you would continue to send this church into the community here, that they might continue to make an impact for your kingdom. But Father, I pray that you would challenge some hearts here today to take some bigger steps of faith. I pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.